Up next, we go under the water to take a look at scuba diving. Central Florida on the water. This is your host, Lou McNally. Snorkeling and scuba diving are popular activities here in Florida ever since the invention of the aqualung in 1943 by Emile Gagnon and Jacques Cousteau. Now, scuba diving has allowed millions of people to experience for themselves the hidden world lying below the surface of the water. And joining us tonight to help us with that is Dr. Philip Krager. He's a scuba diver, an underwater photographer, and a technical diving instructor too. And welcome to the show, Philip.
Thank you.
We got a lot to talk about. So let's just get started with how you got started with scuba diving.
Watching Jacques Cousteau's Silent World movie back in the mid 60s. He was a scientist. He invented the aqualung. He had a ship called the Calypso that he would take his divers out on and go all over the world and dive with whales and porpoises and all different kinds of animals underneath the sea, and I just loved it. First time I saw it, I wanted to do it, but it took me quite a few years, about 4 decades, to actually go in and get certified.
I don't think you're alone in waiting 40 years to do something
right,
that you like to do.
Life happened.
How difficult is it to get certified? I mean, is that the lowest level, the highest level? Or?
Well, there's different levels of certification. Typically, what you start out with is something called an open water or scuba diver certification.
Okay, before we go any further,
sure.
Scuba means something, doesn't it?
Scuba is an acronym for self-contained underwater breathing apparatus, which essentially means is that you have the equipment with you to breathe underwater.
Okay.
You have a tank, you have some other equipment, but you also have something called a regulator, which is hooked to the tank so it allows you to breathe from the tank underwater.
Oh, okay. That sounds
That's very simple.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. But there is there are certain misconceptions about scuba diving though.
In terms of, for example, a lot of people think that it's dangerous,
yeah,
and they think that they're going to be bitten by a shark, mm-hmm, or a barracuda or a moray eel, and mm-hmm, certainly those animals are underneath the ocean. But as long as you don't harass them, you're probably going to be okay. I'm always more scared of getting in my car and driving to where I'm going to dive on I-95 than I am actually getting in the water.
Well, now for folks that might be thinking of maybe picking this up, is there an age limit to scuba diving?
Most of the major organizations now are certifying at the age of 10, which is great because I just got off a boat a couple of weeks ago with a 10-year-old who was, mm-hmm, getting certified. He was diving with his dad. It was his last dive for the certification, and they were having a blast lobstering.
That sounds great. Now, can anybody learn to do this? Are there any restrictions at all?
There can be some restrictions health-wise. If you had diabetes or asthma, those were the two big things that were contraindications to diving. But, mm-hmm, now they really want you to go to your primary care physician to get checked out because those are no longer, you know, absolutely no-nos for diving. But that's something
Let's go through the process of getting started with scuba diving. Do you have to buy everything right up front or... Can you rent the equipment?
You can rent the equipment. You can rent everything that you need to use to get out and dive in the ocean, mm-hmm, to start out with. And typically that's a good thing to do because you don't know whether you're going to go past that. So mm-hmm, once you get past that, though, what they're showing on the screen here is all the equipment that you're going to need to dive.
That's a lot of stuff.
And it is a lot of stuff, but the primary things... if you want to start out and you want to buy some equipment, it's always good to buy your own mask.
Okay.
It's like using your own toothbrush. You know, mm-hmm, you want to make sure your mask fits, and fins, and maybe a snorkel, which is probably going to run you maybe $150 or $200.
Well, a lot of people have already got that gear for snorkeling. Right?
If they do, sure.
Yeah.
I mean, you can use it also for scuba diving.
So what else
would
you need? We have a couple of tanks here.
You're going to need a tank,
mm-hmm,
but you can also, it usually comes, when you're doing your certification, they're going to provide you with the tanks.
Ah, okay.
You also need a regulator, which is the thing I was talking about connect to it. It is complex, but it's very simple to use. All you need to do is to connect it in to your tank, and you fit this in your mouth.
Okay.
Yep. And you breathe, and essentially what it does is that it takes the high pressure from this, which usually starts out at 3,000 PSI, and brings it down to a level that you can breathe from.
Why do you need 3,000 PSI?
Because you need to pump up, put in enough gas that's sufficient for a dive.
Okay.
And so these are rated for 3,000 PSI.
Well, you're not breathing in 3,000.
No, you're not, and that's what the regulator does. Ah. The regulator takes that 3,000 PSI and brings it down to whatever your ambient pressure is.
Which is different depending on how deep you are.
It's on how deep you are, because water is a lot heavier than air.
Mm-hmm.
And so as you go down, the ambient pressure increases, and so you need the regulator to provide that gas, that air to you.
So that whatever you can actually expand your chest.
Yes, and breathe. Yes.
Wow. Okay, so let's take us through a certification process. How do we get started?
You need to contact a dive instructor who usually works for a local dive shop, and they'll sign you up. You'll do some academics, which could be in the classroom or it could be online. And
what kind of academics do you need to do?
They teach you about physics, the way that the water pressure affects your body.
Of course, yeah.
They teach you about physiology and how that's affected by diving. They teach you about safety and the environment and equipment and several different things. And once you go through that, then you're going to get wet. And so they're going to give you your equipment. You're going to get in a pool that's maybe 3 or 4 feet deep.
Like this here?
Right there. That's me in the foreground. I'm teaching my family a little bit of introductory scuba.
Okay.
And if you think about people who freak out, they think, I'm going to freak out, I'm going to drown. It's like, well, you're in 3 feet of water. Why don't you just stand up?
And there's a way out.
there's a way out. Then we take you down to 12 feet.
Mm-hmm.
And then another day, we'll take you to a lake that's 40 feet and do 2 or 3 dives. And your final two dives are going to be in the ocean. And that's why we're learning, is that we want to dive in the ocean. But we start out slowly.
Okay, well, it sounds like it's not a lot different from a lot of other sports, where you have to learn all about it first and then then give it a try.
Absolutely.
Like that. So how about around here, where would we go to do that last dive, that ocean dive? Anywhere?
Technically, you could go out anywhere in Florida, you know, starting with Jacksonville all the way down to Key West, but the really good dives start about Boynton Beach, Jupiter area, and on down to Key West, primarily because
Because we have reefs.
Because the reefs are beautiful, but also the reefs are not 20 or 30 miles out. They're right up near the coast, maybe 1 or 2 miles.
And how deep are they?
It depends on how far you go out. There's actually 3 reefs, depending upon where you are, so it could be anywhere from 20 feet down to 90 feet.
Wow. Okay. So do you find that people have a problem getting over that first fear of actually breathing underwater? Is that a big deal?
Well, remember, yes, apps. I don't think that I've ever had a student that just said, I quit, you know, when we're in 3 feet. You know, usually the vast majority will actually go through and they'll get the certification, then they may drop out for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. But most people continue on and continue to dive.
Okay, so that's the first certification. What comes after that? You said at the beginning of the show we mentioned that you're a technical diver. What does that mean?
Technical diver means when you go beyond the bounds of recreational diving, which is 130 feet, and also the gases that you're breathing. And so also if you're in an overhead environment, so if you go into a cave or a wreck, you no longer have easy access and direct access
you
to the surface. You can't go straight up.
Yeah.
So that's when you start getting into the heavy training, and also your equipment changes.
Yeah, we'll talk about that in a minute. But first of all, let's talk about the reefs. We've got some video here of what it looks like to be diving on a reef. First of all, what is a reef made of? It's more than just rocks, isn't it?
Really calcium carbonate. From stony coral that die, and that actually builds up over time, and then you start getting other coral that adhere to the calcium carbonate, and then you get a reef.
You're in somebody else's world now.
Yes, you're really in somebody else's world, and this was, I think, taken off of Alamorada by our production manager, and there's all different kinds of sea life. There's a barrel sponge. We saw some grunts before.
Yeah, is that those small yellow fish that we saw? They all schooled up together.
Mm-hmm. There's a moray eel.
Oh, look at that! Yeah,
those usually grow to about 6 feet, and as long as you don't bother them, they don't bother you.
Wow.
This is
That's a turtle down there, right?
Yeah. That's a hawksbill turtle. Yes, and you'll see those during breeding season. You have the.
That's not a turtle.
And that's a nurse shark.
you're in their territory.
The nurse shark is the most docile creature I've ever seen out there. Usually they're swimming along slowly, or as you'll see here in a second, they're sleeping under the reef.
Do you need a boat to get out to these reefs, or are there some close?
There is some shore diving down in the Fort Lauderdale area, but most of the diving that you do in Florida will require, the ocean diving will require a boat to get out, because it's usually 1 to 2 miles out.
Wow, that looks fascinating, I'll tell you. So now, you don't need to be a technical diver to go out and dive on the reefs?
Oh, absolutely not. No, you just need your
certification.
Your open water or scuba diver certification for dives down to 60 feet.
Okay.
Once you start going deeper, you need to have an advanced certification.
So besides the fish, what kind of animals would you find out there?
We will find sharks, as you saw there. You'll find more eels, you'll find barracuda, goliath grouper, all different. This is a shot that I took down in Boynton Beach, a couple of sharks.
Do you have to use repellent or anything special? There's
never,
barracuda.
Right no. there, yeah. That's a barracuda on the Spiegel Grove down in Key Largo.
Yeah. So you don't have to have repellent or anything, or you carry
anything with you? No, they don't want to deal with you. No, I mean they will actually swim away. In fact, sharks are the ones that actually will not want to get anywhere near you. The only reason that I got a close up of that shark previously is because somebody was feeding the sharks.
So, if you have your equipment, and you're ready to go. I mean, do you just take your own boat and go out there and put up that red and white flag, or
you can take your own boat? And what most people do, though, they don't have boats. They will go on a local dive shop will run a boat, usually starting at 8 or at 1 o'clock, and they'll take you out for 4 hours. You do 2 dives, and then you bring you back.
Oh, that's a great idea. So and you don't have to have your own
You don't have to have your own boat, and there's usually around $70 for the two-tank trip, and so it's the easiest way to do it.
Now, is it common for people to continue renting equipment after they've reached their certification, or they start getting specialized?
Yeah, it really depends. It's how far they want to go. If they start diving 3 or 4 times a year, you might want to buy your own equipment because it amortizes, over a few years. And it's an easy thing to do. And if you think about, I'm going to give up a couple of trips to Epcot, then go buy your own tanks and BCD and regulator.
We were talking briefly before about technical diving, and you said one of the things about technical diving, besides the depth, is making sure that you can still get straight up.
And no, you can't.
If you can't get straight
up. You can't. You have to go out sideways.
So what about a wreck? Diving on a wreck.
And there's different types of wrecks, and it's called wreck penetration. A lot of the wrecks are old Navy ships that have been sunk on purpose for the very purpose of providing an artificial reef.
They're starting a reef, anyway.
Yes, yeah. And so they break out the windows, they take out the doors, and so
right here,
there
yeah.
you can easily get out one of those windows there.
Okay.
Advanced tech, and that's the flag that's on the Spiegel Grove.
Wow.
Which is one of the largest natural reefs in the United States. That's down in Key Largo. That's the Coast Guard cutter Duane.
Look at that.
Which is also down there in Key
Largo. How deep are these?
Usually, it depends on where you want to start on the ship, but usually starting at 70 to 80 feet all the way down to 130.
Okay, so you're talking technical diving, whether you're going inside that thing or not, right?
Yes. Once you go below 130 feet, then it's technical. You want to be an advanced diver because going from 60 to 130 feet is quite a jump.
And you had mentioned that you're breathing different gases. Do you have a different mixture?
Yeah. Once you go below 130 feet, you can use air, but usually you start having different mixtures, and it's kind of technical here, but air is 21% oxygen,
right.
79% nitrogen.
Yeah.
But you can actually have different mixes where you have 32% oxygen or 36% oxygen, and it allows you to stay down longer. If you go even deeper than 130 feet, you're actually adding helium to your mix, and you're taking out the oxygen.
Wow. You're not breathing oxygen?
No, you're breathing oxygen, but no longer 21%, maybe 18 or 15%.
Well, we got to talk about, I'm sure people are wondering, we have to talk about cave diving.
Yes.
When I was told I was going to be interviewing you on this show, and we were going to talk about that petrifies me. I'm sorry.
But, it does a lot of people.
That's a scary concept, being underwater and under a roof at the same time.
Right.
Is it that much different from a wreck? Or?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
yeah, it is, and it really depends on where you're cave diving. I think cave diving is a wonderful sport that where you really need a lot of training. You need to understand something about yourself when dealing with fear. Most people have issues with cave diving, exceed their training. You're trained to do certain things, and then they don't do them.
Yep.
But there's more and more cave divers that are coming on board every year.
So. Is this a certification that's beyond technical diving?
It's a part of technical diving.
Okay.
Right, it's a part of technical diving.
Now, we're obviously talking different gear.
Yes.
Safety-wise and just physically?
Safety-wise because you can't go directly to the surface.
Right.
Now you need a lot more of everything. And plus, when you're talking about going in a cave, you need lights, right?
Well, right, of course.
And you don't just need one light. You need at least three lights, and I usually carry 4 to 5, just in case,
because
I've actually had 3 lights go out on me in a cave dive.
What happens when the lights go out?
Something happens, something comes loose, a battery dies, something happens. But I was able to get out because I had those spear lights. Mm-hmm.
Tell us a little bit about what you brought here tonight for cave diving.
Okay.
We're down at the end here. That's a much bigger harness.
Yes, that's a much bigger harness over here. This is my cave diving harness, mm-hmm. Which looks totally different from what you would find in an open water rig. Mm-hmm. I have a couple of steel tanks. And actually, these are my baby steel tanks, the ones that I actually dive with when I really go far back in a cave, are about half again this size. I wear this helmet mm-hmm. right here, and I turn on one of the lights so that if my primary light goes out, which is my big light, mm-hmm. that I'm not scared and that I still have that light to see what's going on and kind of reconfigure everything.
I got to ask you, I mean, it must be tough to leave a trail of crumbs in a cave.
Yeah, well... If a cave has been explored, it's going to have a line in it.
Okay.
And there could be multiple lines in it, and that's your way to come home. And
even if the lights go out.
Even if the lights go out, yes. Well, we train to stay near that line. And if something happens, we call it okay the line, and we can follow that out, mm-hmm. even if everything hits the fan.
Here's a video of you heading in for a cave dive. Look, how many tanks you got there? Five?
That's five. I'm probably going to go nearly a mile into the cave.
What?
And so, and I've got that's my big scooter right there that helps me fight the current. You see, I've got my light on.
Where is this?
Okay, that's Jug Hole. It's up in North Florida, and that's me entering the cave.
Look at a sinkhole on steroids is what it is, huh? Look at that. Well, I can see the line there. Okay, so it has been explored.
Oh, yes.
Have you done any underwater spelunking without the line? I mean, finding new...
I've done some exploration where I was the one running the line, yes.
Actually put it
that's,
in there.
That's scary.
I mean, this looks like you're not underwater. It doesn't at all, except when you see you float.
And this is what people think of when they think of cave diving. It's notice how I'm squeezing this little place right here.
Yeah. I mean...
Okay. That doesn't occur everywhere. That just happens to be for this particular cave, although I've done it in several others.
Be afraid to get wedged in or something.
There's some caves that are as big as like swimming through a mall.
Really?
It is that big, yes.
My goodness. Now, you don't have to change your air mixture or anything. It's just strictly due to depth
to depth. And this cave was only, I can't remember, maybe 60 or 70 feet, so I could just use...
A normal mix.
A normal mix is 32% or 36% oxygen.
So you can only go in there half as long as the air that you have.
That's a very good question, because if anything happens... And on your way out, is that if you've only got half, then you're...
Oh, you have to get out without having any issues on the way out.
Right, if you only have half.
So
typically a third. Very good, a third. So it's a third in, a third out, and a third for reserve.
But you're carrying 5 tanks, so I mean...
Yes.
How difficult is it to switch regulators once you're down there, or switch tanks?
It's not very, once you practice a lot.
Yeah, you got to figure it out. Well, let's see. Now, I mean, I can remember Lloyd Bridges and Sea Hunt. I'm sure a couple of people out there can, too. But has the gear really changed that much since the invention of the regulator and the Aqualung and all that?
Yes, they're always making changes to it, but essentially it works the same. It's providing that air to you at the ambient depth.
That looks... I mean, if that light went out, I don't know what. That looks scary. It really does. But I imagine it's just fascinating once you're there, right?
Yeah, it is. It's fascinating. Now notice that these are Florida caves. In a bit, we'll see some photos of the caves in Mexico, which have a totally different environment.
Look and feel.
Yes.
How popular is cave diving here in Florida?
Very. When I started,
locally, I mean, or do people just take off?
Well, there's certain places where you can go cave diving up near High Springs, which is above Gainesville. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of different caves around there, and those places are packed, you know, all throughout the week. And you can also go to the Mariana area or over to the Tampa area, which has totally
different pictures
caves.
Right here, I think.
Okay, that's Jenny Springs up in High Springs.
All right.
And that's my buddy who's got a full set of gear and a scooter ready to.
These are like a day's drive, right?
Yeah, a day's drive.
Day trip, look
and
at that.
That's the scooter running the run. Mm-hmm. That's about 4 feet of water. We're heading to the cave entrance.
That's like a little motor that's in front of you to keep you, against the current or whatever.
Yeah, to fight the current. Now, there's our Mexico caves.
This. It looks like you're standing inside.
The Mexico caves are 80 degree temperatures, 100 degree 100 foot visibility, no flow, and you notice that they had the stalactites and stalagmites, which meant at one point in time these were dry, right?
My goodness, isn't that something? Isn't that spectacular?
But you notice how big the rooms are.
They have a couple of little nooks and crannies I can see too, but boy, that must be fascinating. Look at that. Look at that. There isn't a hint of a current. There's no dust. Look at that.
It's poised, and that's the only photo of me I believe you have.
Which is one that you didn't take.
Right, I didn't take that. And that's also in Mexico.
But you do take pictures. We know that.
Yes.
There you go. I mean, that's a pretty slick-looking rig you got right
That's
there.
My underwater rig, yeah.
That's this
rig
here?
Right. That's
I mean,
the
it's
right
designed
there.
For a particular camera, right?
It's designed for a particular camera because of the controls on it. So you have buttons on the back and then on the front and on the sides so that they actually reach where they need to reach, the buttons.
So you want to get into this, folks, you want to make sure you've got the camera that you like first before you go buy the case that's going to fit around it.
In fact, the camera is, for me, ended up being the cheapest part of the rig.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, and this has got lights
attached. All right, those are flashes. So you think of the regular flash you use on a camera, and those are flashes.
Right.
And you set them up so to illuminate everything, and it's water pressure tested down to, I think, 150 feet or maybe further, so you don't have to worry about it flooding. And I love doing it.
It's a heck of a rig, though, I'll tell you. That looks great. You have to have battery packs along with that, too, right?
Yes, you have to have a battery. The battery pack is on the back of those flashes, so you have to charge those separately, then you connect them, and then they're ready to go.
Gotcha. Well, one of the things that we do here on the show is our tip of the week, and that brings us to Michelle Reed of Discover Diving in Port Orange, and she's going to explain what beginners should look for when picking out a mask, snorkel, and fins.
Hi, I'm Michelle Reed. I'm the owner of Discover Diving Dive Center in Port Orange, Florida. The main reason why you would want to come into a dive center to pick up your mask and snorkels as well as the fins is because the discount dive centers or discount stores, they may have slightly lower pricing. However, the materials that the masks are made of is going to be a little bit less of a quality. The way that you would fit a mask to your face is first, initially, you're going to look for what aesthetically pleases your eye. So say I like this mask. So what I'm going to do initially is I'm going to just set it against my face and make sure that there's no hair in your face so that it doesn't break the seal. Gentlemen have a problem because they have mustaches. That is going to break the seal regardless of the mask that you try and look for. So you may want to just shave off just underneath your nose so that it can seal against your nose. You're going to then put it against your face. Do not push in because that's going to give you a false sense of being able to stick to your face. You want to just push it against your face, but not into your face. And then you're simply going to inhale. And the mask should stick to your face. If there is leaking anywhere on the outside coming through the sides, it does not fit your face. It's not a good fit for your face. And then you want to make sure that the top of your brow here is not touching the lens. Another thing that you can choose aesthetically is if you want a clear skirt or if you want a darker skirt. The darker skirt is going to keep glare out of your eyes so that you can focus on what you're looking at. The clear mask is probably good for people that have a little bit more of a claustrophobia issue or don't like tight spaces. You might want to go with a clear mask. We have just a regular tubed snorkel. This one, actually, all of the snorkels nowadays are made with valves in the bottom to release water. When you exhale into the snorkel, it's going to go out the bottom as well as out the top of the tube. Now, a snorkel fin, usually you don't require a boot to go into a snorkel fin. However, a diving fin, you do need a boot. Unless it has a full-footed pocket to where you just slip your foot in the pocket. But diving fins, generally you need a boot to go inside the pocket. So you just slide straight in, and then you pull the strap up and you tighten the straps with the side straps. So a full blade fin is great for initial divers that are just starting out or initial snorkelers that are just starting out. If you want to go a little bit further into the realm of more technical, maybe a little bit easier of a fin, you're gonna go with a split fin, or there are fins that have little vents in them in the top. Some of our technical divers will use those type of fins. This is gonna give you more propulsion with less effort. Less effort means more time underwater. So remember, when you're trying to come in to buy your snorkeling equipment or your diving equipment, be it mask, snorkel, boots and fins, or a full foot fin, you wanna make sure that you try to stay away from buying things online, because you don't know if it properly fits your face, especially the mask. In diving, you want to make sure that you have a mask that's not going to leak, the lens isn't going to pop out. You want a sturdy mask for diving that's going to hold up to the pressure.
Well, that brings us to the end of the program. I want to thank Dr. Philip Krager. Phil, if somebody wants to get in touch with you about diving, technical diving, or your photography, which was spectacular, we saw plenty of examples during the show, how would they do that?
They can reach me by email at philip@krager.net, or I'm on Facebook as Philip Krager.
Perfect. Sounds great. Well, out there, folks, if you have a comment or a question, please email us at wdsc@daytonastate.edu or go to our Facebook page. And to check us out for our schedule, visit our webpage at wdsctv.org. And you can find other episodes of this series and other local programs, too, online on the WDSC TV YouTube channel. We'll see you next time. Boat safe.